16 days now until Israelis go back to the ballot boxes on March 23rd for the fourth time in just 2 years. The Likud again leading all parties in the polls, but those surveys also show Prime Minister Netanyahu failing to get enough support to form a new government. Can the Likud or other pro-Netanyahu parties get that late spurt of support it needs to remain in power? Well, one of those waging that campaign battle is Likud lawmaker Nir Barkat, who entered national politics after a lucrative career in high tech and 2 successful terms as Jerusalem mayor. He's seen as one of the party's brighter assets and has said himself he believes he is a viable contender for its leadership in a post-Netanyahu era. And he joins us for the latest in our I-24 News Yisrael Hayom election interviews, together with Yisrael Hayom diplomatic correspondent Ariel Kahana. And Nir Barkat, thanks for joining us.
Shalom, good evening.
Good evening. Well, today restaurants, cafes reopened in Israel, but some 4,000 had to shut down during this these periods of lockdown. Your specialty is economics, Nir. How is the government, what does it need to do to help this industry and all the others that have really suffered over the past year?
Well, first of all, today is a happy day. We're starting our first steps post-corona, actually the only and first country to vaccinate all its people, practically a majority of the people. And we're now able to start opening up again. We're in the best position to take advantage of the vaccination process and to grow, to focus on economic growth post-corona, the fastest in the world. And there's no doubt in my mind that that is what's going to happen. Now, naturally...
But it's not that accurate. I mean, Netanyahu keeps saying Israel is going out of the corona. But China, for example, is for maybe a year or a half year out of the corona. And we have New Zealand, we have Australia and other countries as well. So it's, I mean, we are before elections, but saying Israel is out of the corona is not that accurate.
No, what I said is that we've started our first steps getting out of the corona. And you cannot compare Israel to China. You must compare Israel to Europe and America. We're a democracy, a Western society, with all the ramifications of Western society.
I mean, New Zealand and Australia are also democracies, right?
I think that that's not the right comparable, okay? Because they are islands and we're different, and I think that comparing us to... you could do that if you'd like, but I think the more relevant comparables are Europe and the United States. And if you look what's happening, the rate of vaccination in our country and our ability to best take advantage of all these changes and focus on growth, this is a very, very important step.
Nir, certainly credit is given to the government, to Prime Minister Netanyahu and Likud for the vaccination program, no question. But on the economic side, that is costing the Likud somewhat. There are people feeling the government is just not doing enough to help those sectors in need.
Look, let's look at talk about the macro and the micro. On the macroeconomics, Israel has suffered, like all other comparable states, but much less than others. On the micro side, definitely, unfortunately, there are businesses that pay the price. And it's still not too late to give them another dose of help, which is unfortunately is actually delayed because of the bipartisanship of this government. And we must help those businesses. So definitely there's things to do. There's lots of work to do. But I think that if you look at the path of growth and getting out of the corona, it's not in the time. It's not the same time table as the elections.
It brings me to the question about things that have to be done. I saw some very good plans about the economy here in Israel, and you got a promise from Netanyahu before former elections to become finance minister. In case Netanyahu wins, in case you wins, mm-hmm. do you expect to become now after the coming elections finance minister?
Indeed, I have plans, and I've been working on them for a long time, both from my experience as an entrepreneur, as a businessman, and as, thank God, my experience as mayor of Jerusalem. So these plans, some of them were adopted, some will probably be adopted in the future. I'm not talking about my role post-election.
That's my question.
Let's win the elections first.
Okay.
Well, and this is not simple. I think we're in a there are many people that are considering who to vote for, and we must make sure they understand that there are only 2 options. We must win the elections first. And if we don't win the elections...
It doesn't look so. I mean, there is no you have 61, right?
I do want to remind you that you did say at the last election that the reason Prime Minister Netanyahu did not keep his promise to you to make you finance minister because he had to go into a unity government with blue and white.
Indeed.
Not a more narrow government, so there weren't those places with the Likud. Now, There is no excuse for that, because even if the Likud does succeed in forming a government, it will be a narrow government.
Let's talk about that the day after the elections. Let me focus you on the biggest challenge we have. And then these are the right-wingers that are considering who to vote for, Likud or Bennett and Saar. And when you look at the alternatives, Bennett and Saar will not join the Likud. So he only has an option to work with Lapid and Meretz. And we'd heard today from the Arab parties that they will support Lapid. So they're going to be, even if they work together, they're going to be one-third of the government. So they will never be able to fulfill the right-wing strategy. They will never be able to restructure
the... You're bringing this point for about a month now. The fact is still, although what you say, you're saying Saar will cooperate with Lapid and with the left and with the Arab leagues and so on, still you do not have 61 in any poll.
It depends on the voting pattern of the right-wingers. If they stutter and go for Bennett and Saar, their vote will join Lapid, and it's going to be a tilted left-wing government.
If you take votes from from Bennett, it's in your block, okay? So maybe you have to attack Saar, but I'm not sure attacking Bennett is that smart from the Likud aspect.
If he joins the Likud, maybe yes, maybe no. We don't know. Then we will have hopefully we'll pass 61. But if he doesn't, what's going to happen? What's the alternative? One is to have a fifth election. And the third, which is even worse, is to have a left-wing government. Lapid, Meretz, Avodah, Lieberman, and the Arab parties supporting it. So eventually the right-wingers will never be able to fulfill a right-wing approach. A right-wing approach in that new government.
Well, since you raised the possibility of a fifth election, and you have to say, looking at the polls, it's a possibility. After four elections in which Prime Minister Netanyahu has either not been able to form a government or not been able to form a stable government, maybe it's time for the Likud to start looking for the possibility of new leadership. And you yourself have spoken of yourself as a potential contender for leadership. You've said you could lead the Likud to victory.
Post Netanyahu.
Okay.
And right now, that's not the question. The question is, do the right wingers in our country want a decisive election, or they want to have a fifth one, or vote right and eventually have a left-wing government? That's the only two options. I'm repeating myself, but that is the real question that our voters and our spectators have to decide.
Okay, so coming back to the current elections in 2.5 weeks, right? Is Benny Gantz, after the bad experience you had with him in the current government, is he someone you might join your coalition the day after, from your aspect?
The Likud will propose the strategy, the vision, and the actions we want, plans, what we want to do in the future. Anybody that wants to join that vision will be happy to take him.
If
it's Lieberman, if it's Bennett...
Benny Gantz suggests to make changes in the legal system here in Israel. That's the Likud platform, right? Benny Gantz is against it. Would you, for example, sacrifice the reforms in the legal system for having government with Gantz? Is that a possibility?
Saar and Bennett will have to they'll have to give it up. They will not be able to help.
And you?
The Itiashvut in Judea and Samaria. They will not be able to reform... anything on the legal system, and I believe that they will not be able to boost our economy because the rest of their friends in the government are socialists and not liberal.
Okay, liberals. And what about you cooperating with Gantz the day after?
If he agrees to our agenda, he has to agree to the agenda that the Likud is proposing. When I was mayor of Jerusalem, I had a right-wing approach, and I enabled minorities to join us. Including Meretz were part of my coalition at the time, because I knew I had a huge majority even without them. So if he joins four or five parliament members to a 60 majority, 60 plus majority, then he will have to accept the majority.
Yeah, but if not, if you have like the polls, like you have 58 without Gantz, and Gantz brings you more four seats, you have 62, but he says, I'm going to be the justice minister, for example.
That's why we want a majority.
Yes, but we don't have it
without him. So, look, eventually we'll have to see how we form a government, and with the, you know, being very honest, you want to have a stable, large, homogeneous government.
Well, I want to ask you about
and not a heterogeneous government.
So
you have to make all kinds of compromises.
To go to the issues, you're talking about a homogeneous government of the right. There is now an administration in Washington that does not want to see more construction in the Jewish in settlements in the West Bank, that does want to see a return in some form for the Iran nuclear deal. So how would that kind of government you're proposing be able to function against and maybe in conflict with this new Biden administration?
We've been in such a similar movie before. I want to remind you, when I was the mayor of Jerusalem and Netanyahu was elected in 2008, Obama was elected as president of the United States, and we had a very tough time with the administration on these issues. And then, and I think Netanyahu showed lots of flexibility and maneuvering to be able to maintain that relationship with our best ally and friend.
With Tzipi Livni as one partner, then later followed by Yair Lapid.
That was very difficult time. We don't want to go there,
of course. But Jerusalem was freed. Tachless, practically, it was
not really,
for many years.
But yeah, we had a tough time. And then when Trump came along, thank God, and was elected prime minister, we were able to make bold, aggressive, smart, and very important moves for Israel, moving the embassy, Ramat Golan, etc. So now I think that with the new administration, it's probably going to be somewhere in the middle. They accept. The pressure we put on Iran, and they understand that Israel has an existential threat, which is called nuclear bombs with Iran. We will never let that happen, and there are many ways to do that. I believe that the new administration will join us on that
threat. I just want to remind you, then Vice President Joe Biden coming to Israel furious about construction in the Jewish neighborhood Gilo. You certainly remember that very well.
Yeah.
That was the Joe Biden that you had to deal with at that time.
Indeed, I remember that very well. And we're not in a perfect world, and we have to understand how to work with Israel's best friend, which is America, the United States of America, and how to manage these issues. I believe that it's not going to be Obama. It's probably not going to be Trump. I'm maybe speaking as what I wish that will happen. But eventually, to work with the Americans, I think I know nobody better than Netanyahu. Nobody better. Understanding how they work, how they think, working with the different administrations. And that is a big risk that we don't want to let Yair Lapid and his people lead the relationship with America, the war, the combat against Iran, expanding peace, the Abraham Accord, which is a huge accomplishment. Let's not forget that. We're sort of forgetting
these
accomplishments.
Let's go back for a minute, if I may.
Okay, briefly.
Briefly, about the construction in Jerusalem. You were the mayor. Are you worried you might be taken or called to the ICC because you ordered building in Jerusalem?
I'm afraid you have 20 seconds to answer that.
Do I look like somebody that gets frightened from anything? The ICC is not a legal court. It is a political anti-Semitic move. Which is very unfortunate. You know, there's a very Jewish phrase that if you become soft with the bad guys, eventually you become hard with the good guys. And that's what's happening. Rather than attacking terrors all over the world, they're now going after us. They got it all confused.
We'll have to end on that note. Amir Barkat of the Likud, thank you for joining us.
My pleasure.
On I-24 News and Ariel Kahana.
Thank you, Ariel.
That ends the first